Welcome to worship in the Unitarian Universalist Church of Charlotte. Today is one of a few times a year when we are lucky enough to have our elementary age children with us in the service. Welcome to each of you. Model homes are tidy and inviting from the outside. There's a clean, bright layer of paint, and the windows sparkle. But when you walk inside, you sometimes find drawers in the kitchen that don't actually open. The walls are decorated with a vague sort of hotel art, if they're decorated at all. You get the sense that no one has ever walked barefoot on the living room carpet, let alone spilled coffee on it. And you might look over and see a large bowl of plastic fruit. Lovely, tidy, but not something that could really feed you. Gratitude sometimes can feel like this. A lovely idea, a lovely, tidy something that can feel hollow. Gratitude can sometimes feel like more of a social expectation than an actual experience. What if gratitude was something we lived in comfortably and knew intimately on good days and bad days? A joyful response to being alive in an often unfair and unkind world. In search of gratitude that is real and life-giving, we worship together. Welcome, members, welcome, guests, welcome, all.
Thank you. weak and bring grace to the strong. May all evil stumble as it flies in the world. All the tribes come and the mighty will crumble. We must brave this night and have faith in love.
We're grateful to our children's choir for singing in both services. So since they've done that, that's why they are taking their exit now. Our reading this morning comes from the Buddhist teacher and author Pema Chodron. She writes, "The slogan, 'Be grateful to everyone,' means that all situations teach you. And often it's the rough ones that teach you best. If we were to make a list of people we don't like, people we find obnoxious, threatening, or worthy of contempt, we would find out a lot about those aspects of ourselves that we can't face. This gets at the guts of how we perfect ignorance through avoidance, not knowing that we're putting another layer of protection over our heart. The main point of 'be grateful to everyone,' the dig, is that you want to get rid of the situations that make you most uncomfortable. You don't want to be grateful to them. You want to solve the problem and not hurt anymore. This slogan encourages you to realize that when you've met your match, you've found a teacher that will help you be open to a challenging situation so that the basic goodness of others and your own basic goodness begin to communicate." Once upon a time, in the land of plenty, there was a kid named Zed. And Zed lived with his family, and it never seemed like they had enough of anything. Not enough heat to warm the house, not enough food to fill their bellies. Of course, the land of plenty had a help center where families like Zed's could go if they needed help getting through the week. But the thing about the help center was that the Council of Matters Big and Small had decided that the most cost-effective and nutrient-rich way to deal with poverty in the land of plenty was to serve nothing but canned beans, rain or shine. The problem was Zed didn't like beans to begin with, and eating them all the time was almost unbearable. So Zed went to see the Council of Matters Big and Small. The members of the council all sat in big, tall chairs and looked down on Zed as he walked in. The president of the council leaned forward and said, "Yes, what do you want?" Zed pulled himself up tall and said, "Hi, I'm Zed, and I wanted to lodge a complaint that some families have too much and some families have too little. My family gets food from the help center every week, and I'm here because I'm sick of beans. I want lasagna and cooked carrots and chocolate pudding for dessert. Surely all human beings deserve that at the very least." The council members looked surprised and then grumpy. The president of the council said, "Zed, what makes you think you have the right to get more than your fair share?" Zed tried to say, "You see, it doesn't feel like a fair share," but no one could hear him because rather than listening for a response, the president had turned to the other members of the council and they were all muttering quiet and then loud about how rude children could be these days. The president of the council decided to sleep on it before making a decision. Plus, Zed's talk of lasagna and cooked carrots and chocolate pudding had made her hungry, so she went home and ate a big plate of all three. After a comfortable night's sleep, the president decided that even though it was true that Zed deserved more than a can of beans, Giving everyone enough to live comfortably just wasn't practical. The brass tacks of it was that the land of plenty didn't have the infrastructure for such a radical change of routine. So instead of addressing Zed's concerns, the president told the council of matters big and small that Zed's request was too difficult and idealistic and therefore not a priority, and they should move on to something else. And so Zed's family went on getting too little, and other families went on getting too much, and it wasn't fair, and it wasn't right. Whether we're in kindergarten or third grade or adults, we know that this isn't the way the story should end. Zed's story is sad and frustrating. We don't want some people to have too much and some people to have too little. This story reminds us that the world is not as it should be, that there is a strategic imbalance of power, resources, and opportunities in our world, our country, our city. I know that when I run into the difficult truth that I live comfortably in a world of such stark economic disparities, when I run into these difficult truths, I want to turn away. Or I want to believe that it makes the world better, it helps solve the problem, if I simply try to feel as grateful as I can for my abundance. When, of course, the difficult truth is that no matter how grateful I am, my gratitude will not correct the carefully protected imbalance of wealth. My gratitude will not make it okay that I have so much and others have so little. We heard earlier what Pema Chodron had to say about difficult truths. She said, the dig is that we want to get rid of the situations that make us most uncomfortable. We want to solve the problem and not hurt anymore. Pema Chodron goes on to say, difficult feelings provoke all our irritations and bring our habitual patterns to the surface. And this becomes the moment of truth. You have to choose to stay with the rawness and discomfort of the situation and let it transform you. It's a lie to think that if we could just learn to get away from the painful things, then we would be happy. We have to sit with the painful things, the impossible. This impossible can't solve them overnight kind of things. Until we find our way to meaningful change, until we find a different way of existing together. We'll never get closer to our impossible hopes without this practice of sitting with the rawness and discomfort of injustice. But how do we do both? Hold injustice in our world and our gratitude at the same time? And do we dare give thanks in an unfair world? Do we dare give thanks in an unfair world? Do we dare find delight and joy in a world where there is suffering? Yes, of course. Unitarian Universalist minister Robert Walsh says, "Life is a gift we have not earned and for which we cannot pay. There is no necessity that there be a universe, no inevitability about a world moving toward life and then self-consciousness. There might have been nothing at all. Gratitude can't take away the suffering of others. Gratitude can't make life fair. But then expressing gratitude does not have to be a hopeless attempt to pay a debt for all that we have. Gratitude can be a thanksgiving, an astonished, joyful response to being alive." I had the same teacher for second and third grade, and her name was Carol. She was everyone's favorite teacher. After recess, Carol would have us sit in a circle and she'd read aloud while our heart rates calmed enough to focus again on classroom work. If it was your birthday, Carol would tell you all the ways she had seen you learn and grow during this last year of your life and why the world was a better place with you in it. And you really got the sense that she'd been watching you, that you mattered, that she was grateful for your existence. Carol took the time in the midst of all the demands of the classroom to notice and help us notice what was good and beautiful. As an adult, I kept in touch with Carol. Once when I was visiting home, we went out for dinner. We enjoyed the conversation so much that we made a habit of seeing one another whenever I was in town. And slowly I learned more about Carol's life than I had ever known as a kid. She'd had a difficult first marriage, made worse by living on a shoestring budget. For a time, she'd been a single parent with two young children. She'd been underpaid at hard jobs, being behind a cash register for years before she began teaching. She'd battled cancer. Carol's life had not been an endless stream of blessings. So many things had not gone her way. She knew life was not often fair, and she couldn't help feeling grateful. Her gratitude was a real, no strings attached response to being alive. Gratitude was not a payment for blessings received. It was not about taking an account of the good and the bad in the world and deciding whether or not she should be grateful. She just was. Elizabeth Tarbox writes, "I give thanks for the opportunities to love that present themselves in the turmoil of life, where the light catches the tears in another's eyes, where hands are held and there are moments without words. Let us be present then. Let us stand in the morning on damp grass, hear the syllables of birdsong and fill up on sweet air that rolls over oceans and continents. Let us look up at the stars and the planets that fill the night sky with majesty. Let us witness the first fresh buds of spring amid the brown sticks of winter. And for all of this, let us be grateful. Let us not defend ourselves against the discomfort of unruly emotion, nor seek to close down our hearts for fear a new love will come to shake our foundations. Let us instead be open to discovering a new way of seeing an old problem, or appreciating the perfection of a seashell, or the possibility of friendship. For in giving ourselves to what we do not yet understand, we receive life's blessing. In a world so unfair, let us sit with the pain of the struggle, trusting that the rawness and discomfort will indeed transform us. And in the midst of it all, dare to give thanks.
Welcome to today's service, whether you are here in this room, in our alternative worship space in the Bernstein Room, watching this service by way of our live stream, or viewing an archived video of this service. We're honored to have guests here with us today. Our members would like to greet you following the service. So that we might do so, if you are visiting, please raise your hand and keep it up. Members, please take note of guests. seated near you. After the service, invite them to join you for coffee and conversation in Freeman Hall. Should it enhance your experience of future services, you can find both a large print order of service and a personal hearing assistance device on the table at the entrance to the sanctuary. If you'd like to learn more about us, please fill out a yellow card and place your completed card in an offering basket when they are passed later in the service. Members with a life event to share can do so on the reverse side of the card. You'll find them along with offering envelopes on the clipboards at the end of the row. Please begin passing them down your row now. Some returning visitors may be interested in hearing about how to become a member. If so, talk with our membership coordinator, Kelly Green. Her contact information is on the back of your order. Again, to each of you, welcome. I am so grateful for this church, and I believe in what we're doing. I love that we have chosen to go in a bold direction and act with the urgency that this unique time in history requires. I don't think there was much of a choice considering who we say we are, but doing the right thing is hard, and I'm proud of us. This place has done so much to educate me. For example, I learned in a talk related to racial justice that impact is greater than intent. I found out firsthand that this was true last Wednesday when I went out to do karaoke with the intention of sounding awesome. But the impact of my actions was I hurt people's ears. I didn't mean to hurt them, but I hurt them just the same. So what do you do when you hurt someone? You apologize. But not everything is fixed with a simple apology. I might need to practice a lot. I might need to put in work to show that I'm serious about not hurting people in the future with my words and music. I'm sorry to say that this story is true in the literal sense, but it is also, of course, a metaphor. We can have good intentions and still hurt people. When that happens, we can't center and prioritize our feelings at the expense of others. And when we work for social justice, we need to educate ourselves before we rush in and try to be rock stars. Sitting in these pews, I've had my mind blown so many times. It was here I learned about the Moral Monday movement and Charlotte Uprising. I heard speakers like Reverend William Barber, Derek Mitchell, James Ford, Bree Newsom, and so many others. Those people came here to speak because they think we're worth their time. What an honor. Let's make sure we are. I could go on and on about how great this place is. I did go on and on in other versions of this reflection until I realized my kids were going to be bored, wiggling, and too far away from my dirty looks to have any effect. We are tapping into a beautiful legacy of activism. Who knows where we will end up or who we will inspire on the way? We can do this.
Thank you, Beth, and amen. We turn now to the life of our congregation and the wider world. And as we do, it's my pleasure to introduce Richard Pratt for an announcement on behalf of the Memorial Endowment Trust.
Good, beautiful morning today. As Eve said, I'm Richard Pratt. I am one of the trustees of your Memorial Endowment Trust. In this season of thanksgiving and gratitude, I would like to thank everyone who has contributed to the Memorial Endowment Trust over the years. Your heartfelt gifts in memory of a loved one, in honor of a special person or special occasion, and legacy gifts, those being gifts included in wills or other estate planning documents, all make it possible for the Memorial Endowment Trust to make or to award grants annually for special projects around the church that fall outside the scope of our annual operating budget. Examples of some of these grants are the video system here in the sanctuary, as well as the video screens in the Bernstein Room and the Fellowship Hall. Other examples include the relatively new interior signage throughout our church facility, and most recently, the updating of the Freeman Fellowship Hall. So by contributing to the Memorial Endowment Trust, you are in effect helping to plant trees that will provide shade and shelter to future generations of UUs. Thank you.
Thank you, Richard. If you'd like to learn more about our congregation and opportunities we offer, you can read through the back of your order of service, you can explore our website, or you can subscribe to our weekly e-newsletter, Currents. On Sunday evenings, December through March, we provide meals and shelter for our homeless neighbors through a program called Room in the Inn. Please see the link in Currents or visit the adult programming table to sign up to volunteer. Tomorrow evening at 6:30 in the Bernstein Room, we're going to have the second opportunity for our families with one or more children in second through fifth grade, plus siblings of all ages. We're going to get together to learn why the chalice is the symbol of our Unitarian Universalist faith, and also take time for families to make their own family chalices. And a friendly reminder that if November is your pledge month, pledges are due. Thank you. As we look ahead to Thanksgiving this week, we give thanks for the many lives that make up our congregation, for the coming together of this community to hold one another in sorrow and in joy. We hold in our hearts Terry Robinson and Nancy Rubin. Upon the death of Terry's mother and our longtime member, Betty Robinson. We are sending love to Craig Miller and holding him in our prayers as he grieves the death of his mother, Madeline Miller. We're sending love to Karen Record Leach and her husband, Don, as Karen recovers from surgery earlier this week. We celebrate with parents Lorna Burns and Wright Thompson and big brother Micah on the birth of Bryn Emily Thompson. We celebrate with Sharon Walker and Dave Walsh as they welcome their first grandson, Daxton, born to daughter Christina. And we send our belated congratulations to Chris and Kate Richard on the birth of Della Marie Richard. There is great need this week, as always, to send our love and prayers beyond these walls. On Tuesday, there's Transgender Remembrance Day, and I wanted to share some words with you from First Unitarian in Brooklyn that they used in a worship service honoring Transgender Remembrance Day. Broaden our imagination to see divine love in the faces of all those we meet along the way. May we see that our teachers come in all shapes and sizes, all genders, and all sexes. We especially hold dear this morning the lives that were lost due to fear, hatred, or self-doubt. We pray for our transgender youth who feel alone, unwanted, unloved, or unliked. May our love, our compassion, and our commitment to seeing a world more free and more free-spirited help them to celebrate who they are and bring them hope when it's hard to find. If today feels particularly meaningful for you in some way, there's a joy or sorrow or remembrance that you are carrying, you are welcome, member and visitor alike, to come forward later in the service when the offering baskets are being passed and music is being played, and to light a candle in silence. Would you be with me in meditation and aspiration? Breathing deeply and maybe allowing your shoulders to relax away from your ears. And in the quiet, take a moment to reach out to your source of strength, your source of hope. As I offer these words from Lynn Cox. Spirit of life, ground of our being, root of unified mystery growing into myriad branches of expression, bring us together now. Quietly, attentively, waiting with slow breath. Help us to remember, help us to piece together our oneness that matters. May we rise, star stuff, walking and rolling across the surface of an impossible blue-green planet. May we join together to heal what is divided. May we find wholeness within, without, among, between. Eternal source, seed of the universe, help us to grow peace. Amen.
What we give to this place doesn't disappear. It comes back to us as a cup of coffee, working lights, a well-placed package of Kleenex, or an event that changes us. We will now give and receive the offering. Mm-hmm. Please join me in an affirmation of our faith, rising in body and our spirit. I am a single cell in a body of
Thanksgiving this week promises to bring you quiet or chaos, or something in between or beyond, be well. Please be seated.